Harper Audio presents Breaking Addiction, a 7-step handbook for ending any addiction by Lance Dodes, MD. Read by John Meagher. Introduction. It was 1 o'clock, and Ron Golding returned to his desk from lunch to find a manila envelope sitting there, laid on top of the papers he'd been working on. He looked at the outside of the folder. It was from accounting. "Email isn't good enough for them," he said with annoyance as he opened the envelope. Inside, there was a thick, stapled pile of forms with a cover sheet. He glanced at the forms. They were filled with questions and boxes to be checked. He dropped them on his desk and read the cover note. "Dear Ron," it began, "we need to have these filled out by 5 p.m. and returned signed. It's for the quarterly report, and the legal people say it has to be in their hands today. Sorry, Beth." Now he dropped the letter and picked up the stack of forms again, stared at them, and finally sat down. Turning the pages of forms, he shook his head. "Damn," he said. "Hey, Joey," he called. Joey was at his own desk, only 10 feet away. "Yeah? Hey, did you get a pack of crap to fill out for accounting?" Joey made a gesture at his own desk. "Yep, I got it." "Well, I can't do it," Ron said. "I've got too much to do." "I know what you mean." "No," Ron said, "you don't understand. I mean, I really can't do it. Larry is on my back to get a draft to him by tomorrow morning." He leafed through the forms again. "There's at least an hour of work here. And look at it. It's idiotic." He shook his head again. "It's just a damned waste of time. My time, your time, everybody's time." "I'm with you," Joey said, but he turned back to his computer and seemed done with the exchange. Ron ran his hand through his hair, then picked up the phone. "Ginny," he said when his wife answered, "I'm going to be late tonight." "I know, but I have to stay and get this done." "Probably about 7. Just tell the kids we'll make the fort tomorrow." "I know." "Yeah, see you then." He leaned back in his chair. At that moment, he knew what he was going to do when he finally got out of there. Ginny didn't like him coming home and drinking, but he sure as hell was going to get a drink tonight. At the bar on the way home. Maybe more than one. He looked down at the pile of forms. Yeah, definitely more than one. He sat forward. Now that he'd decided to go drinking, he felt less stressed. Now he could get to work. What is addiction? We are barraged with theories that attempt to answer this question. If you suffer with an addiction or care about someone with an addiction, you may already have found that a lot of people are not able to get well with the usual treatment approaches. This book describes a new way of understanding and managing addiction that I have been writing about in professional journals for the past 20 years and summarized in a previous book, The Heart of Addiction, HarperCollins, 2002. As the director or psychiatric consultant for 4 major addiction treatment programs and as a therapist in private practice for over 30 years, I developed my ideas not by telling people what they should do, but by listening carefully to them to understand the reasons why they had an addiction, why it became so hard to control, and why it overwhelmed them when it did. Over time, I came to see addiction in a new way, one that is very different from older approaches. Indeed, if you are used to those older ideas, you may find these new concepts a bit jarring. But since the publication of my first book, these ideas and methods have been utilized by therapists and treatment centers and taught in educational programs around the country. Breaking addiction is the result of feedback I've received indicating the need for a more hands-on, step-by-step blueprint to make this new approach more accessible for people suffering with addictions, for those who live with them and care about them, and for those who treat them. This book is also intended to help you if you are unsure whether or not you have an addiction, or if your interest is just to better understand the nature of addiction. How this book is organized. In part 1, I will summarize how addictions work, continuing the story of Ron to illustrate this. I'll turn in part 2 of the book to the individual steps in the mastery of addiction, from the beginning to the end of the process, illustrating each step with case examples. The final chapter of part 2 is entitled Test Yourself. It's designed to give you the chance to apply what you've learned to the stories of several people suffering with addiction. Part 3 is a guide for family members and loved ones of people with addictions. As you'll see, once you understand how addiction really works, you are in an excellent position to repair relationships and families that have been damaged by addiction. Finally, Part 4 specifically addresses professionals who treat addiction, describing ways this new approach can serve as the foundation for professional treatment. Part 1. A New Way to Understand Addiction. Everyone knows that addictive behavior is not good for you. People who suffer with addictions may know this best of all because they've lived it. But addiction persists. Strange as it may seem, it must serve some purpose. In fact, its purpose must be so great that it is even more essential than avoiding the bad consequences of the addiction. It has to be more important than losing marriages, families, friends, jobs, and health. It has to be more important than losing your license to drive or to practice in a field that you care deeply about, more important than the pain of hurting people you love. What could possibly be worth all of that? In terms of the outside world, the world of careers, family, and success, there is indeed nothing worth losing at all. The purpose of addiction must lie in the inside world, where what is at stake are feelings central to emotional survival itself. If this is the case, then nobody would be surprised to find that it overrules even the most important external causes. Let's return to Ron from the introduction to see how this works. Ron. When Ron was 7 years old, he was playing in his room, that he shared with his older brother, when he heard shouting between his parents. This happened a lot. He caught many of the words when they were loud, but most of it meant nothing to him. Something about money, usually. But he felt the familiar sense of torn loyalties, and he wished his parents would just stop. The noise ended, and a moment later his mother came into the room. "Ron, I have a headache, and I'm going to lie down. Company is coming over, and I need you to straighten up the living room. And put the bathroom towels in the laundry, please. I'm in the middle of building a Lego castle, Mom. I really need you to do this for me now. Can I just finish this part? Look, see, I've got the wall all up on this side, and..." "Ronald, I need you to do this right now. Can I just show you?" But his mom had turned around and was walking up the hall to her room. After cleaning up, Ron was returning to his room when his father saw him. "Hey, Ron, come here." Ron walked over and looked up at his father. "Listen, I've got to take your brother to his baseball practice, so I need you to take out the dog."
"Aw, Dad, I'm in the middle of building a castle."
"Sorry, kid. Plans have just been shaken up. Your mother was going to take Ben to practice, but now I've got to do it."
"Aw, Dad, do you have to go right now? The castle is standing up, and I just need to..."
"Talk to your mother about it," his father said, grabbing his keys from the side table before going out back to get Ben.
When Ron was 12 years old, his parents' fighting had increased. There was trouble with Ben, who was now a 14-year-old giant and rarely listened to either parent, which seemed to Ron to make things that much worse in the home for everyone. Ron had regularly fought with Ben over the years, the way brothers do, but now it was worse because there was no fighting. Ben just ignored him. Ron did his best to interest Ben in anything Ron could think of, but capturing his older brother's attention was a lost cause. Ron's mother seemed to need him even more to help her out, since she spent more and more time in bed. His father had become more tightly strung, too. Ron tried hard to keep the peace, but the task was impossible. Ron was washing dishes for his mother when his father called from the garage.
"Hey, Ron, I need you out here."
"I'm doing the dishes."
"For your mother?"
"Yeah, she's not feeling well."
"Bullshit," his father said. "When does she feel well? Come out here and help me drag this mower out of the corner. It's a mess over here."
"Mom said she needs..."
"I don't really give a good goddamn what she needs. Get over here and help me."
Ron dried his hands and went out the back door. He thought about shooting baskets at the outdoor court nearby. Jump shots, driving to the hoop, fooling around with the hook shot he was forever working on. That's what he wanted to do. 20 years later, when Ron got the stapled pile of forms to complete before 5 p.m., he was furious. Others had gotten the same forms, but they weren't nearly as upset. What set off Ron, and what did deciding to have a drink have to do with fixing the problem? Knowing something about him, it's simpler now to figure this out. Ron grew up with some lasting scars. In itself, of course, this doesn't make him unusual. Nobody comes through childhood without at least a few marks and bruises, both physical and emotional. Just from the couple of incidents I described, you can probably make a good guess what these were for Ron. Ron felt unheard. Even though both his mother and father loved him, they were too often preoccupied with their own concerns, including their battles with each other. The fact that his parents loved him enabled him to grow up generally healthy from an emotional standpoint. But being loved was not enough without also being shown that his parents were deeply interested in the things that were important to him, interested just because they were important to him. Like all children, Ron needed to know that he was a priority in their lives. But it was clear to Ron, though he might not have been able to put it into words as a child, that his parents' priority was their own needs. He was somewhere lower on the list. And Ron worked hard to comply with their view. He wanted peace, and he wanted to please both his parents, even when they each demanded different things from him. In the end, he adapted by treating himself the way they treated him. He sacrificed his needs for theirs, out of his longing for them and to be heard by them. This got him through the years, but it left a scar. Over and over, he had burned with resentment at feeling overlooked, and anger he could not express to the parents he loved. Partly this was because he already felt hopeless about being heard, and he was trying to make peace in the family, not more trouble like his brother was doing. He was trapped, unheard and helpless to make himself heard. And by trying to give his parents what they expected, he became part of the very system that enveloped him. Quite unintentionally, he added to his own sense of helplessness. So, what happened when Ron got the forms 20 years later? The company needed them by 5 o'clock. They also needed his draft to be prepared by tomorrow. His wife needed him home, and so did his kids. They couldn't all be pleased. It was impossible. Oh, and by the way, he thought, did anybody ask what he needed? Did anybody think about the bind they were putting him in? In his frustration, he thought that when it came down to it, did anybody care? Did anybody listen? Ron was trapped in the way he'd felt helpless his whole life. That was when he thought about drinking. The purpose of addiction. I asked earlier what could be so important that it would lead otherwise sensible, intelligent people to ruin their lives by repeating an addictive behavior. Ron's story illustrates the answer. When he thought of having a drink, he felt better. Importantly, this was not because he had any alcohol in his body. It was enough for him to anticipate having it. To understand why this helped, we need only look at the feeling he had at the key moment when he first considered drinking. Once Ron had touched on the idea of stopping by the bar on his way home, he was able to get to work on his forms. He had felt instantly relieved. Why? The answer is that Ron's decision to drink relieved his feeling of helplessness. He could, entirely in his own control, take an action that would make him feel better. He was the master of his internal life, of his feelings, and he was taking control over not just any helplessness, but the kind that touched on the central emotional problem of his life. Sure, he was still realistically mired in contradictory outside obligations between home and work, but at that key moment, what mattered to his very core was reversing this particular sense of helplessness that was now, and had always been, intolerable to him. By God, he might have to work late, but he was not going to be a pawn pushed around by the needs of others. Not that day. This is the purpose of addiction. Addiction is a behavior intended to reverse a profound, intolerable sense of helplessness. This helplessness is always rooted in something deeply important to the individual. Why understanding the purpose of addiction matters? Because it explains why people with addictions are not weaker than people without addictions. People suffering with addictions put up with helplessness just like everyone else, as long as it doesn't involve major issues for them. If you have an addiction, you know this very well. You are quite able to put up with most day-to-day frustrations without necessarily feeling you need a drink, or to place a bet, or to eat. Just like everyone else, you deal with the ordinary brickbats of life without needing to turn to your addiction. Understanding this, that the purpose of addiction involves managing deeply important feelings, helps to undercut the mistaken idea that people with addictions are weak or fragile. I will return to this point in step 2.
Because having an addiction is not the same as being impulsive. This is another common myth. To the contrary, folks with addictions...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.